We're continuing our series on the Sermon on the Mount, which is the first recorded sermon from Jesus Christ. And if you think about it, this is pretty big because this is not coming from any one of the pastors or any one of the religious leaders, but this is coming directly from Son of God. Chapter 5, 6, and 7 in the book of Matthew is where we find this Sermon on the Mount, and it teaches us how the kingdom of God functions. And if you really desire to be faithful disciples, citizens of God's kingdom, this is what you want to study. And so we started this series in the beginning of this year, right now we're in chapter 6. We just finished studying the Lord's Prayer last week, and we're going to continue with verses 16 through 18 from Matthew chapter 6. And it talks about fasting. Chapter 6 talks about three fundamental disciplines, actions, and practices of Christian living, and that is giving, praying, and fasting. And today we're going to look at this specific practice of fasting together. The first thing that I want to mention is this, that in the kingdom of God, fasting is an essential discipline. And some of you may not like this, but fasting is an essential discipline. When was the last time you fasted? Show of hands, anyone? Okay, a couple of you, good. In the kingdom of God, fasting is something that is essential and foundational. Jesus assumes and expects you to fast. I don't know if you noticed today's verses, but it says, when you fast, in verse 16. It doesn't say, if you fast. If you feel like fasting. No, it says, when you fast. Verse 17, we see it again, when you fast. Not if you fast, but when you fast. It's because Jesus assumes and Jesus expects that you will incorporate this discipline of fasting in your walk with God. And we saw this when Jesus was teaching about giving and praying. He didn't say, if you give, he said, when you give. He didn't say, if you pray, he said, when you pray, pray like this. The most fundamental and foundational actions and practices and disciplines of faithful citizens of God's kingdom. Christians are called to give. Christians are called to pray. And we Christians are called to fast. You cannot be a Christian and not be a giving person. It just doesn't work that way. You cannot be a Christian and not pray. How does that even work? You cannot be a Christian and not fast. Fasting is absolutely necessary for all and every Christian. We see fasting in the Old Testament. The Old Testament commanded fasting on the Day of Atonement. Everybody had to do it, no exception. We see that in Leviticus and Numbers. It says, you must deny yourself. You must not work, and you must stay away from food on this Day of Atonement. We see it again during exile. Jewish people expanded their practice of fasting. It was a very customary discipline for them. It was very normal for them to fast before God. Nehemiah fasted for confession and repentance. He could have just prayed, but no, he brought fasting upon his confession and repentance. King David fasted to seek God's intervention, and he prayed for justice. Mordecai and the Jews fasted upon hearing the news of Haman's wicked plot for their extermination. They were so desperate that they just couldn't pray. They had to fast together. That's what we see in the Old Testament. And some of you may ask, well, that's in the Old Testament. We're in the New Testament days, so we don't really have to fast, do we? Well, let me tell you a very interesting story that we had with our brother Sam this past Friday. So he was telling me, he was very serious. I walked into the room before FNF, and he was very serious. And he says, well, I read in the Old Testament that Christians are not supposed to eat pork. Pork is an unclean animal. I read in the Old Testament. So he told me that he's been staying away from pork this whole week. He had like a company lunch or dinner, and he was just trying his best to stay away from pork because that's unclean animal, yo. Right? And then he went to Costco one day, and not being mindful of this whole Christian-y thing, he picked up a box of Spam. And he really didn't know what was in this can of Spam. Nobody knows. But maybe pork is part of it, right? So he's been telling me that he just didn't know what to do with this whole box of Spam. So I told him to give it to me because I love Spam. You see, we find all these rules and laws and disciplines in the Old Testament that we don't necessarily find in the New Testament. How are we to understand it? Is there some kind of disconnect? And I tried to explain this concept of how Jesus in the New Testament came and fulfilled the law for us, and we have freedom in Jesus Christ. And if abstaining yourself from pork brings a closer relationship with God, by all means, you should do it. But by the same token, if abstaining yourself from YouTube, let's say, brings you to a healthy, intimate, close relationship with God, by all means, you should fast YouTube. By the same logic, you have to assess your lives and see what helps your relationship with God and what does not help, and be able to stay away from those things that may deter you from having a healthy, intimate relationship with God. But this is something that I told Sam. I admire your passion for God. I admire your passion that you try to stay away from pork this whole week. Just having this conflict with this can of Spam. Should I eat it? Should I not? I told him I admire your passion for God. What about fasting? How does that play out in the New Testament? Well, in the New Testament, we see this discipline of fasting continuing on. The early church fasted while worshiping and committing their ministry to the Lord. They also sought the Lord through fasting for guidance and sometimes for confirmation. Even Jesus, he fasted before his ministry. In the Gospel of Luke chapter 4, we see Jesus, before he began his ministry on this earth, he was tempted by the devil. And before he was tempted by the devil, he was led to the wilderness where he was tempted, but he fasted for 40 days before he encountered the enemy. Luke chapter 4, verse 1-2, it says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Fasting makes you get hungry, and we don't like being hungry, do we? One of the reasons why we don't like the idea of fasting is because fasting is going to bring us hunger, and we don't like that feeling of being hungry. But Jesus fasted for 40 days before he faced the devil, because fasting is something that had to take place before he was able to face the enemy. And in this, we see that fasting is going to bring something supernatural. Fasting brings something supernatural. And Jesus models for us what we are to do. And if fasting was necessary for Jesus, it absolutely has to be a part of our spiritual walk with God. Because it opens up a whole new dimension of power, and that we cannot get any other way. That's why Jesus assumes us and expects us to fast. Biblical fasting can be defined as abstaining from food for spiritual purposes. Simply going without food is not considered fast. Simply going without food because it's not available or because it involves some kind of a medical reason, that cannot be considered biblical fasting. Some actually think that fasting is a way of diet. That's not true. Oh, I gotta lose some weight, so I'm gonna go on fasting. No, that's not biblical. You gotta go on fasting for some spiritual purposes. There must be a spiritual motivation to qualify a fast as biblical. John Piper, in his book Hunger for God, said this: Christian fasting, at its root, is the hunger of a homesickness for God. Christian fasting is not only the spontaneous effect of superior satisfaction in God, it is also a chosen weapon against every force in the world that would take that satisfaction away. Well said, huh? Fasting brings this divine, superior satisfaction. And not only that, it gives us a weapon to fight against anything that would take away that satisfaction. We have to fast. No wonder Jesus fasted for 40 days. For him to leave his home and to make his dwelling among us, he had to stay focused. He had to be empowered to effectively do his ministry and to stay away from things that were irrelevant to God's kingdom. That's why he fasted. And Jesus is teaching us to do the same. For us to stay focused in the kingdom of God and on his wills, fasting is absolutely essential in our Christian living. So how are we to fast? Number two, we have to fast in secret. Jesus teaches us to fast in secret. Fasting is humility and submission before God. It's not a reason to boast before men. All three actions that Jesus teaches us in chapter 6, giving, praying, and fasting, Jesus talks about hypocrites. How hypocrites try to show their action of giving. How hypocrites love to sound aloud with their prayer. How hypocrites, they love to show that they are fasting. They look gloomy. But Jesus says, no, you don't need to do that. When you fast, fast in secret. You see, fasting is such an intimate connection between you and God. It is between you and God, and it's an intimate discipline that no one has to know about. Sometimes a group of people or the whole church can fast together. But aside from those corporate fasting, when you fast alone, no one needs to know about it. No one needs to know about it. And the only way the others will know that you are fasting is if you tell them that you are fasting, and God doesn't want you to do that. Why? Because then you are seeking people's reward. You are seeking people's praise. You are seeking people's approval. We know how to call for attention. When we fast, we love to look gloomy and disfigure our faces. Just make it so obvious that we are fasting. I was browsing through Facebook the other day, and I saw this person posted a selfie of himself, and the caption said, fasting. I'm like, thanks for letting me know. What's the whole deal here? It's between you and God. The whole world doesn't need to know that you are fasting because God knows. If your motive behind fasting is to get people's praise, that's what you will get, and you might as well enjoy them because that's all you'll get. God is preparing his divine reward. But when you already receive the reward from people, God can't give his. That's why Jesus teaches us that fasting needs to be done in secret. Christians are to be seen doing good works, but we must not do good works simply to be seen, especially when it comes to fasting. If Christianity and the practices of Christianity is something you are abusing to be seen by others and to be praised by those around you, you will never get to experience God the way He wants you to. Think about it. Sometimes Christianity becomes sort of like a competition. I read 5 chapters of the Bible this week. How many chapters did you read? I came to FNF this past week. Where were you? It's almost like a competition. I'm fasting 3 meals a week, and it's been going on for 2 months. Are you fasting? I'm sponsoring 10 children in Africa. How about you, bro? Christianity is not a competition. It's between you and God. And God sees you in secret. Yes, we could share our journey to encourage each other and empower each other. But when this thing becomes sort of like a competition where all you're doing is boasting yourself just to get people's approval and praise, God is saying, how can I give my reward when you've already received yours from other people? Fast in secret. God sees you in that secret moment, and God will reward you. Which brings us to our last point. Number 3, fast to indulge in a better relationship with God, and that's the reward that we get. Fasting brings us this reward of having that opportunity to indulge in a better relationship with God. It's natural for us to think of fasting in negative terms, and it's understandable because fasting is abstaining. It's about going without food or drink. It's about having to endure empty stomach. Not many people like that idea. And it definitely discourages us from actively pursuing this discipline consistently. But Bible is very clear on this. Fasting is not about losing and giving up. It's about getting something special. That's why I titled today's message, Not Full, But Filled. It's so easy to make ourselves full of things, but inside we're not really filled. Fasting is not about letting go and giving up, because through fasting, you will get something. Something special. Something powerful. All 3 actions that we see in the chapter 6 of the Gospel of Matthew talk about rewards. When you give, give in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, pray like this, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you fast, fast in secret. Verse 18, it says, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. This is promise. He's not saying, maybe I'll do something nice for you. Maybe I'll get something nice for your Christmas. No, he says, I will. It's a promise. I will reward you. When you fast, fast in secret, and I'll see you, and I will reward you. God loves to reward us. He is not a mean, greedy stranger next door. He is our good, loving Father. And He loves to reward us. He loves to bring rewards. He loves to bring encouragement. He will always bring confirmation, wisdom, grace, and truth. And that's exactly what He wants you to experience through this discipline of fasting. Biblical fasting brings us into a closer union and relationship with God. while our bodies are being deprived of the fullness of food, God promises to draw near and fill us of His Spirit. While our bodies are being deprived of the fullness of physical food, God promises to draw near and fill us of His Spirit. And this is a spiritual certainty, and it is a promise. As we decrease, Spirit increases. As we decrease, He strengthens us and renews us. Brothers and sisters, let's fast together. Fast brings humility and mercy. Fast brings satisfaction and sanctification. Fast brings gratitude and thankful heart. Fast brings repentance and turn of direction. Fast brings spiritual strength and empowerment. Fast brings unity and clear conscience. Fast brings guidance for and before a turning point. Fast brings justice and righteousness. And fast brings God's kingdom and God's will here and now. And through fasting, we will get to enjoy God's reward that He so wishes to bring upon your fasting and emptying of yourself. When I asked you if you've fasted recently, I only saw a couple of hands. And to be honest, I can't even remember when the last time was for me. But in preparation of this message, I was really convicted that I was very negligent of this discipline in my walk with God. And I made some plans to find those days to fast for the rest of this month, especially as I pray for Hana Church and for the upcoming transition. So, you know, at first I thought about maybe like setting a day and like fasting together, but I wanted to give you the freedom. I wanted to give you the opportunity to maybe set aside a couple minutes, 5-10 minutes, maybe 20 minutes, and stay away from food and just stay focused on God, His kingdom, and His will. And would you join me in fasting and praying as we close this year of 2019 and look forward to next year and all the transitions that God is bringing towards our church? So find those ways to get connected to God through fasting. And let's witness together all the great rewards that God is preparing for all of us. Let's pray together.